at this second appearance to take oath of the presidential office, there is less occasion for an extended address than there was at the first. Then a statement somewhat of detail to be pursued seemed fitting and proper.
Now, at the expiration of 4 years, through which public declaration had been constantly called forth on every point and phase of the big contest,
which still absorbs the attention and engrosses the energies of the nation,
little as new could be presented.
The progress of our arms, upon which all else chiefly depends, is as well known to the public as to myself, and it is, I trust, reasonably satisfactory and encouraging to all, with high hopes for the future, no prediction as regard to the adventure.
On the occasion corresponding to this 4 years ago, all calls were anxiously directed to the impending civil war. All ready, all sides were averted.
While the inaugural address is being delivered from this place, devoting all together to save the union without war, urging agents from the city seeking to destroy it without war, seeking to dissolve the union and divide effects by negotiation.
Both parties deprecated war, but one of them would make war rather than let the nation survive, and the other would make it accept war rather than let it perish.
And the war came.
Fondly do we hope, fervently do we pray, that this mighty scourge of war may speedily pass away.
Yet, if God wills that it continue until all the wealth piled by the bondsmen, 250 years of unrequited toil shall be sunk.
And until every drop of blood drawn with the last shall be paid by another drop of the sword. As was said 3,000 years ago, so it still must be said.
The judges of the Lord are true and righteous altogether.
With malice towards none, with charity for all, with firmness in the right as God gives us to see the right.
Let us strive on to finish the work we are in, to bind up the nation's wounds, to care for him who are born of battle,
and for his widow and his orphan,
to do all which may achieve and cherish a just